Hi, welcome all of you to the first chemistry session of 12th standard. We are starting with physical chemistry. The first chapter in NCERT is solution. So let's see which all topics to be covered today. The first three, that is definition, properties and classification, you might be knowing, but for introduction, I'll just go through this topic. Then we will discuss units of concentration, that molarity, molality, then percent strength, mole fraction, etc., etc. This also we have already discussed in 11th standard. Then in solubility, it is solubility of solid and gas in liquid. Here there are some new topics, that is Henry's law and all. So one by one, I'll discuss all this today. So the first is, what is a solution? It is a homogeneous mixture of two or more components. Now, you know, mixture can be of different type, that is homogeneous and heterogeneous. Homogeneous means which has uniform composition throughout. Now, solution has two component, solvent and solute. Now the solvent is one which is in larger amount, and solute is one which is in smaller amount. Together they combine to form solution. Now, as you know, chemistry has many exceptions. So according to a different concept, solvent means the component whose physical state is same as that of the solution. For example, if we add sugar or salt in water, then the physical state of the solution is also liquid. So water is solvent here, and sugar or salt which we are adding to water, that is the solute. Next, we will move to properties of solution. The top five properties are, first one is the definition, that is it is a uniform homogeneous mixture. Second is the particle size of the solute. Particle size of the solute is the is very small. It is of the range of the diameter is of the range of 1 nanometer, and because of this small particle size, other properties come. The first one is, components of the solution cannot be separated by the method of filtration. Why? Because in case of filtration, the pore size of filter paper is not small enough to resist the solute particles. So solute and solvent cannot be separated by the method of filtration. There are other methods for separating them. For example, evaporation, crystallization, etc., etc. Then the next one is, solution cannot scatter light. This property is also known as Tyndall effect. Now, Tyndall effect can be observed in case of colloid and suspension. And this is because of their bigger particle size. In case of solution, since the particle size is very, very small, so they cannot scatter a beam of light. The last property is, solution is very stable. It's the solute particles will not settle down even if we leave it for a longer period, which is normally observed in case of colloid and suspension. Colloid in some cases they are stable, but suspension in some time the particles will settle down, but that is not observed in case of a solution. Next, we will discuss type of solution. Actually, solution can be classified depending on various factors. One factor is the number of the component. Now, here mainly we will discuss the binary solution. Binary means where there are only two components, solute and solvent. Mainly the classification here we will discuss based on the physical state of the component, that is solute and solvent. So let's see this table here. Different types, 9 different types of solutions are given, where in the first 3 cases solute is in solid state and solvent is solid, liquid and gas. Now the example of the first type, that is solid is alloy. Alloy means, you know, it is mixture of 2 or 3 metals like brass, bronze, these are alloys. Amalgam, that is also one type of alloy. Then it is solid in liquid, that means liquid is the solvent and solid is the solute. Example is aqueous solution of sugar, salt, etc. Then it is solid in gas, like sublimation of certain substances in air. Next type is, the number 4 is, where liquid is the solute and solvent is solid. Examples are various hydrated salts, then amalgam, like where mercury is dissolved in other metal. Okay. Fifth is liquid in liquid, acid in water, alcohol in water, benzene in toluene, many other examples are there. Then number 6 is liquid in gas, water vapor in air is one example of that. Number 7 is gas in solid, where hydrogen gas is absorbed in different type of metal, like hydrogen in palladium, hydrogen in platinum, hydrogen in nickel, all these are example of gas in solid. Then gas in liquid is soft drinks, aerated drinks. Gas in gas, what is that? Air. Air is a mixture of gas in gas. And if we consider a small place, air is a homogeneous mixture also. So you have to note down all these examples. They are very important for objective questions. We'll move on to the next topic, that is unit of concentration. Here we have to discuss each of them in detail. The first one is mass percentage. Now in mass percentage, the definition is mass of solute upon mass of solution multiplied by 100. And here unit of mass of solute and mass of solution should be same. Next we will move on to the volume percentage. Now volume percentage can be defined as volume of solute by volume of solution multiplied by 100. Next is mass by volume percentage. Here you have to be very careful. Mass of solute in gram and volume of solution in milliliter multiplied by 100 will give us mass by volume percent. The fourth unit of concentration is parts per million. Parts per million can be defined as 1 gram of solute in 10 raised to the power 6 gram of solution, that is parts per million. Next we will move on to mole fraction. Mole fraction means it is number of mole of one component divided by total number of mole. Suppose there are 3 components A, B and C. So mole fraction of A is denoted as XA, mole fraction of B is denoted as XB and mole fraction of C is denoted as XC. This A, B and C should be subscript. Okay, I could not write this as subscript, but this all A, B and C should be subscript. Now these 3 are mixed together and mole fraction, summation of mole fraction of each of them together will give us 1. Now mole fraction of A is number of moles of A divided by total number of moles of A, B and C. Similarly, mole fraction of B will be number of moles of B divided by total number of moles of A, B and C, and xc also same, number of moles of C divided by total number of moles of ABC. Next we will move on to molarity, which is the most important one. Now molarity can be defined as number of moles of solute divided by volume of solution in liter. Okay, molarity is denoted by capital M, and mostly you know in case of titration and all we use this unit. The last one here is molality. Molality will be used as we will proceed to the next topics in the same chapter, solution. You will see that molality will be used in case of discussing colligative properties. We will come to all those afterwards. Now the definition of molality is moles of solute by mass of solvent in kg. Okay, be very careful about the unit. These things will be needed in doing numericals. Okay, next we will move on to solubility of solid and gas in liquid. The topics to be covered here are definition, factors affecting solubility, there are various terminologies, and Henry's law. Now the definition of solubility is, it is the maximum amount of substance that can be dissolved in a specific amount of solvent at a specified temperature. Okay, the factors which affect solubility are nature of the solute and solvent, temperature and pressure in case of gas. Especially gas pressure has no effect in case of solid or liquid. Now the solubility of solid in a liquid, it's an equilibrium of two processes. The first one is dissolution, where the solid is getting dissolved in liquid, and the reverse process is crystallization. That means when solid particles is coming out of the solution and going back to the solid state again. Now the dissolution, that saturated solution when we are obtaining, that is actually the equilibrium point where maximum amount of solid is getting dissolved in the liquid. So depending on the concentration of the, depending on the amount of the solid which is dissolved in liquid, solution can be divided into different type. The first one is saturated solution, which means where maximum amount of solid is dissolved in a particular amount of solvent at a specified temperature. And if the amount of the substance is less than that, then it is known as unsaturated solution. If it is more than that, then it is known as supersaturated solution. Okay. Next we will see the factors which affect solubility of solid in liquid. The factors, the first factor is the nature of the component. Nature of the component means, suppose there is a polar solute. Polar solute will dissolve in polar solvent and non-polar solute will dissolve in non-polar solvent. For example, sodium chloride is a ionic compound. It's polar. So sodium chloride will dissolve in water, but benzene, which is a non-polar substance, will not dissolve in water. Benzene will dissolve in toluene. Okay, so we can say in one line that like dissolves like. Polar dissolves in polar, non-polar dissolves in non-polar. So this is how the nature of the solute and solvent affects solubility. Next it is the effect of temperature. Temperature, how it affects, it actually depends on the enthalpy of solution. Okay, as we have studied in Leach-Atelier principle last year, if the process is exothermic, that means if the process of dissolution evolve it, then on increasing the temperature, solubility will decrease. And if the process is endothermic, that means if on dissolution it gives out heat, then on rising the temperature or increasing the temperature, solubility will also increase. So these are the effect of temperature on solubility. Pressure has no effect. Pressure has no effect for solubility of solid in a liquid. Pressure can affect the solubility of gas only. Now next we will discuss the factors which affect solubility of gas in liquid. Here also the nature of the solute and solvent is one factor, temperature is another factor, and pressure is the last factor. So nature of solute and solvent, actually in case of solid in liquid we can say that like dissolves like, but here it is not like that. There are certain gases like oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen. These are very less soluble in water. Okay, but gases like ammonia, then sulfur dioxide, then hydrochloric acid, they are highly soluble in water. Then coming to the effect of temperature, have you seen boiling water at home? Gases coming out, the bubbles coming out, those are actually the dissolved gases inside. That means on increasing the temperature, solubility of gas in a liquid always decreases. Next is the effect of pressure. All of you know the example of aerated drink, right? So if we increase pressure, solubility of gas in a liquid always increases. Okay, and quantitatively this effect of pressure can be given by Henry's law. It is, Henry's law is actually a quantitative relation between pressure and solubility of a gas. Now before starting with Henry's law, I just want to discuss the effect of pressure on solubility of gas in detail. Actually when a gas is dissolved in a solution, in a solvent, there is a dynamic equilibrium established between the gas phase and the solution phase. If we see this diagram, the upper part is gas and this blue part is the solution, and both are in equilibrium. That means the number of gas molecules entering the solution is equal to the number of dissolved molecules leaving the solution phase. Now if we increase pressure here on the solution phase, then what will happen? Some more gas particles will dissolve in the liquid. Okay, and this will increase the number of gaseous particles per unit volume, and as a result solubility will also increase. So increase in pressure will lead to increase in solubility of a gas, and hence we can conclude the concentration of the dissolved gas is proportional to the pressure of gas, and this relation is quantitatively given by Henry. Now in Henry's law it is said that the pressure of the gas over a solution in which the gas is dissolved is proportional to the mole fraction of the gas dissolved. Now if we draw a graph between the partial pressure and mole fraction, y-axis is the partial pressure of B component and x-axis is the mole fraction of B component, we will see a straight line is passing through the origin. Now you know, if the partial, we are saying that partial pressure is proportional to the mole fraction. Now you know, if there is a proportionality factor, there will be a constant also. In this case the constant is denoted by KH. Again I'll say this H should be subscript, which I was not able to do, and this KH is known as Henry's law constant. Now different gases have different KH values at the same temperature. This suggests that KH is a function of nature of the gas. Okay, higher the value of KH at a particular temperature, the lower the solubility of gas in the liquid. This also, this you can calculate from this relation. See, if KH is more, then XB will be less for a particular temperature, and hence if KH is more, XB will be, that is solubility will be less. Next we will move on to limitation of Henry's law. Henry's law is valid if the pressure is low. At very high pressure, the law becomes less accurate and the proportionality constant shows considerable variation. Second limitation of Henry's law is that it is valid if the temperature is not too low, if the gas is not highly soluble and the gas neither reacts chemically with the solvent nor dissociates or associates in the solvent. So these are the factors we need to keep in mind while discussing Henry's law. Next, we will move on to application of Henry's law, which is very, very important in our practical life. Now, in case of scuba diving, when a person is going deep into the sea, due to increased pressure, some gases will dissolve in blood, like nitrogen will dissolve in blood. Now, when the person is coming up, the pressure is decreasing and as a result, nitrogen starts bubbling out. This is a medical condition. Remember, this is not a disease. This is a medical condition known as bend. And to minimize this bend, this medical condition, in oxygen cylinder, we fill up some helium also so that the solubility of nitrogen become less. So this is one practical application. The second practical application is the soft drink. In case of soft drink, in aerated drink, gas is dissolved under pressure. So as soon as you open the cap of a soft drink, you will see some bubbles coming out, effervescence coming out. So this is also one application of Henry's law. And the other application of Henry's law, the last application is in higher altitudes where oxygen is less, people get easily tired. And this is also one medical condition. It is known as anoxia. So these three are the application of Henry's law. Thank you all so much for your patience. I hope the topics which we have discussed today is clear to you. For any further clarification, you can always message me. Thank you once again.